Now listen, you queer.
Right,
stop calling me a crypto Nazi.
Let's stop calling names.
I'll slap you in your goddamn face, and you'll stay plastered.
Would you call God material or immaterial?
Immaterial.
What is something that's immaterial?
Something not extended in space.
Can you give me an example of anything other than God that's immaterial?
Lost logic.
This educational system is going to fail you. I graduated from college believing exactly as you believe.
Oh yeah, hey, here we go. Episode 25, 40 Ounce Hemlock. Drop the beat. Yes.
All right, well. Welcome to the show. This is episode part 5 of the current series, Unmasking Antifa. Episode 25 of the podcast overall. My name's Nick. Did I say that? What do we do here? Oh yeah, social media, all that stuff. 40 Ounce Hemlock. Appreciate it. Stay in touch. That's about it. Oh yes, yes, yes. Today. Music's fading already? Oh well. Who am I? What am I? You know what I am? I'm a guy who I'm sorry. I go to the grocery store and I want a certain kind of yogurt. But it turns out that the flavor, like say blackberry for instance, of yogurt that I want is only available in like low-fat or non-fat yogurt. Now there is a section of the shelf that is just like whole milk yogurt, but it's super limited, right? And the dominant category is low-fat or non-fat. Now, I know at a glance, this just seems like, oh good, like health conscious, right? But just think about this. If the rest of your diet is so flawless that yogurt is where you have to cut back. I mean, one of two things, right? Either you don't have a problem in the first place, right? Or you're eating way too much yogurt, okay? It's not the fat content of the yogurt that is the issue at that point. I just don't get it. It's like, it's so unsubstantial. Just give me fat in my yogurt. Just give me whole milk yogurt and make it all available to me. That's all I'm asking. Anyways, it's just not, you know, it's, you know, wet work, breakfast, you know, you have these certain expectations. Anyway, so we got to get right back to it. And I'm ready. If you're ready, I don't want to do a lot of recap because I said at the end of last show, we're going to move right into this thing we touched on at the end. And when we do, what's going to be our approach?
When the mic is in my hand, I'm never hesitant.
Thank you, Fife. All right. So I said we were going to get right into Marx because I ended last show by giving you this statement, this quote from the beginning, the first line of the Communist Manifesto that I said, if you'll notice, has this form that we've been discussing in the context of our ridiculous thought experiment about Norwegian basketball players. All the best basketball players are Norwegian. Bring me counterexamples. Michael Jordan, well, he's Norwegian. Why? Because I have this theory that says that all the best basketball players are Norwegian, right? All of human history, all of social history is the history of class struggle, right? And the resultant oppression. All human social history. All of this thing is that sort of thing. Now, I hope it was clear by the end of that discussion, at the point at which we sort of resolved the thought experiment and started moving into examples, I hope it's clear what the issue is. But I don't know if I really gave it, laid enough emphasis on the words. So I just want to lay some emphasis on the words here. What we're talking about is ideology versus, you know, science. If we look back at those two kinds of statements that we discussed, the synthetic and the analytic, we say that you're informed in the synthetic. You learn something in the predicate that you didn't know in the subject. So this becomes the vehicle for scientific observation statements, right? I observe that the chair is red. When from a distance, I only saw a chair. I wasn't able to identify a color. But now I see that the chair is red. See, I knew the chair before. I didn't know its color, but I've observed that it's red. So there's something in the predicate that was not contained in the concept of the subject. But if I just say the chair is a chair, then I've said nothing at all. It's true, but I've said nothing at all. Now, the reason that's so is because chair is identical to chair. But what's interesting about that philosophically is that therefore the concept of chair is contained. I know it seems trivial at this point. It seems like a truism. It is a truism. But just listen, it's a truism because the concept of the predicate is contained in the concept of the subject. Okay? So when Marx tells you that all social history is the history of class struggle, the question we want to ask him is, what would count as a counterexample to your statement? And if he says nothing at all, or through experience we learn with him that nothing at all would count as a counterexample. Now, how do we learn this? Well, hold on, just hold on. Just suppose we get the impression. I mean, look, well, we'll get to this in a minute. At a certain point, right, we bring him counterexample after counterexample. I think we mentioned some. I mean, we just think about this. Marx, if Marx's statement is going to stand, then nothing else can be a cause of human social history. Class struggle is the one prime moving efficient cause of all social history. Do you see? Now, so you might want to say, but what about some other, like, I mean, couldn't, like, laws being passed or wars happening or technological innovation or some academic or intellectual advance or some political movement or nationalism or other political events, couldn't these be causes, right, of human social history? Marx, no, 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 and no, right? Why? The answer to the why question is the crucial point here. If it's because Marx can, you know, explain why they're not, okay, but if it's just because he has this theory that says that any evidence you bring before him is going to be a piece of, an example of class struggle, well, then you have an endless task. You're never going to convince him because he's going to remodel each thing you hand him in light of his theory. He's going to make the basketball player Norwegian. This is why falsifiability is such a crucial concept, right? I mean, just think about it. You have an endless task. The only way it's not an endless task is if you go to him and you say, okay, I need to know, if you say there is no counter instance to your theory, then I need to know from you what you are counting as a counter instance. I need to know what would count as a counter instance. He has to be able to identify that. But of course, he's not going to do that because he has this theory, you see? Okay, so let me read you something real fast. This is a great just sort of summation of what we've been talking about. This is great. There is a... There's this great French philosopher. Now, stop there, because I know that sounds crazy. I'm kidding, a little bit. I swear, this has been quoted in like three straight books that I've read for some reason. I guess, so I'm like supposed to share it or something, or I'm reading too much of the same kind of thing. Listen to this. This is Raymond Aron. This is from a book called The Opium of the Intellectuals. He says, to declare flatly that a worker in a capitalist factory in France or in the United States is by definition exploited, and that a worker in a Soviet factory is not an example of synthetic thought. It's pure nonsense. It's merely a convenient way of substituting, ready, verbal gymnastics for a painstaking investigation of reality. End quote. Investigation of reality, science, verbal gymnastics, simply defining evidence in light of your theory, right? Simply arguing by definition. Now, okay, so I feel a little bit vindicated by that because, I'm not alone in what I've been trying to do for the past three episodes here, three and a half. Anyway, so nothing we bring to Marx is going to do. Because all human social history is the history of class struggle. Everywhere that Jack looks, he sees deception. Everywhere there's excellence, Jack sees oppression. If there can't be counter evidence for Marx, then there can't be evidence for Marx. And there's not evidence for Marx because Marx's theory, Marx's statement, is not a something he learned from the evidence. It's a lens through which he sees the evidence. That's why he's able to recategorize and reclassify or bring anything or subsume any potential counter evidence within it. So you bring him, just drop my book, you bring him what you take to be a counterexample. And he simply explains to you how, in the end, what you thought was the cause of human social history, some law passed or some, movement or what, how that itself was really explained by class struggle. See? And you're off to the races, because now anything you bring, this will be the game. It's not informed by the evidence. It's a lens through which the evidence is seen. Everywhere that Jack looks, he sees deception, and everywhere there's excellence, Jack sees oppression. If something doesn't seem to be an instance of deception or oppression, don't worry. Jack will explain to you how it actually really is if you knew what was really going on, right? It's a lens through, so any potential counter instance is subsumed. This is the same. It's a framework. I keep saying the word lens, or you could use the word framework. It's a framework in which the evidence is arranged. Just look at with the climate change issue, right? So we discover through the panel, the United Nations, IPCC, whatever, panel discovers that the reality of the warming they've been asserting is totally unsubstantiated by the evidence. So instead of saying we've been unsubstantiated, they change the model for measuring the change in temperature. They change the framework and then say, no, look, it has been warming the way we said it was. But they changed the framework that had informed the original assertion. Do you see? Subsumed within the framework. It's a lens through which the data is seen. It's not learned from the data itself.
I mean, I suppose I have to mention here, right? There's a sort of famous anecdote where the philosopher, the German philosopher Hegel, who more on him in a minute. But the German philosopher Hegel, who's notorious for almost like you could arguably sort of giving a systematic philosophical justification to this ideological way of proceeding. But that's arguable, and that's a side point. Hegel, it's said that one of Hegel's students approached him and said, but the facts, professor, they don't fit your theory. And Hegel is said to have responded, well, then the facts be damned, right? It doesn't matter because I have this theory, okay? And this theory will decide what counts and what doesn't. So no matter what we bring to Marx as evidence that there are some things that happen among humans as social creatures that don't seem on their face or after a second glance, to be instances of class struggle or oppression, what's he going to do? He's not going to allow it. He's going to keep reinterpreting. And you keep coming back with new instances. If it happens once, you're like, all right. If it happens twice, you're like, all right. If it happens three times, you're like, okay. And if it happens four times, you're like, all right. And if it happens, you see what I'm saying? At some point, you're going to say, oh, I get it. You're an ideologist. And he's going to say no, but then by him saying no, of course, you'll know that he is, right? Anyway, we're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back to this point, but then we're going to shoot off from it. So I suppose I should just talk about Hegel for a second,
which is one of the last things I ever imagined myself saying on any occasion in my life. If you know a little bit about Hegel, I guess that might be funny. But we should say something about Hegel here. I sort of gave that anecdote about him before the break, but let's just review real fast. There's a sense in which this is laughable, but bear with me for a second. You kind of need to know who Hegel is to understand what's going on here. Now, Hegel was just a philosopher, and Hegel had this crazy idea that I'm going to put even more crazily to sort of like get the point across to you quickly. Essentially, all of reality for Hegel is a mind that is coming to more concise and accurate knowledge of itself. A single mind, one thing. He calls it the absolute. Okay, weird, wild, wacky. Yes, like I said, I can't say more about it here. But the point here, actually there's two points. One is that the means by which this happened for Hegel, the means, if you had to describe it, I think the best way to describe it would be a means of conflict. Hegel is imagining the conflict of ideas, two opposing ideas, you know, and by opposing, I mean in the logical sense, in the sense that both independently seem to be true but are conflicting with one another. Hegel's idea is that the way this, you know, story of this mind coming to better and more accurate knowledge of itself plays out, the sort of mechanism by which this happens, I know this is crazy, just let me get through this, it's important, is the sort of conflict of ideas sort of like clashing with one another. And what happens in this conflict is essentially the two, well, one subsumes the other, but in subsuming the other, it is also changed itself. So you get out of the two things, you get a third thing. Okay? If you're taking a class, you know, you'll hear the terms thesis, antithesis, and synthesis, but it doesn't matter. It's just this idea that for Hegel, the world, ideal history is the real history of reality. An ideal history is a product of this clash that we're talking about. This clash at subsumption and change. Okay? Now, why am I saying anything about this guy right now? Because Marx was super, super, super taken with Hegel. But he just changed one thing. And the thing that he changed was the thing that I just mentioned. I said, for Hegel, the real history is the ideal history. The real story of the world, of reality, is ideal in nature. It's idea, right? And the rest of it plays out accordingly. For Marx, Marx says, well, kind of, but you got one thing wrong. The real story is material. And the real story about how we got to this point in reality is this conflict of material forces. And since we're talking about human societies, this conflict of material forces are people and the classes that comprise them. All hitherto existing society, history of society, says Marx, is the history of class struggle, class warfare, etc. But do you see? Do you see? He's just changed Hegel slightly, and now it's materialistic. All right? But it's the same idea. There is this inevitable thing happening. Something is destined to happen. For Hegel, it's ideal in nature. For Marx, it's material in nature. Communism is destined to happen materially on the earth. It's just a matter of when. It's an inexorable process. It will happen. The forces are in motion and have been since time immemorial. It's a material process. For Hegel, it was a mental process, right? But nonetheless, for both of them, this process explains everything. So if you bring them something, they're going to explain it in terms of this process. Right? Like, what am I going to give up? My theory? Look, I know that Michael Jordan, initially you might think that the fact that, you know, Michael Jordan is comparatively dark complexioned and grew up in Wilmington, North Carolina, and, you know, right? Initially you might think that those would be really good reasons to doubt my theory that all the best basketball players are Norwegian. However, I find it best to just grit my teeth and hold on to that thing and find a way to explain those other facts. This is just what Marx did. He finds a way to explain all the facts in terms of class struggle. So he's not giving you a scientific statement about the world. He's not observing that all history is class struggle. He's not deducing from observations that all history is class struggle. He is declaring that all history is class struggle. Now, I keep saying Marx, right? And a moment ago I said communism. And it's probably at a certain point necessary, right, to just sort of, okay, do it. Just be clear that we know what we're talking about here, right? Here's another one. Socialism. Okay, now we've got three. We got to get clear on these, right? So I've got a cup of coffee in my hand, and it's mine because I paid for it. So I don't think there's anybody who would dispute that if anyone owns this cup of coffee, it's me. So, and what I can do with this cup of coffee is I can drink from it. I can twist off the top and put it back on again, and I could throw it away. I could dry it out, light it on fire, provided I didn't hurt anybody or burn anything down. There weren't regulations governing where I could. Oh, wait, look. What did I just say? As long as there weren't regulations governing where I could. Let's think about this for a moment. You'll find that if you try to get at what it means to own something, essentially what it comes down to is just having the power to do as you will with that thing. Having the right to do as you will with that thing, or the means to do with you. Maybe not the means, but the power. The power of disposal, von Mises calls it, okay? The power to dispose with something as you wish. If I have this cup that I just said I have, but you come along and you're like, well, yeah, it's yours, but you can't pick it up and drink from it after 3 p.m., or before 10:30 a.m., you always have to say the word vacuum cleaner before you take a sip from it. And you can't set it down unless you've taken at least 2.5 sips from it. And you just start laying on me all these stipulations about what I can and can't do with the thing. But you preface them all by saying, yeah, it's yours, but. At a certain point, if your list gets long enough, we're going to have to stop and ask if I do, in fact, really own the thing.
The point of that is just to sort of bring out that the kind of intuitive definition of ownership is just the power of disposal. And so if you take that concept and now ask about any given, resource or product or capital or anything of value, who owns it? Well, who has the power to, decide what's done with it, in other words. Socialism is just the view that the government ought to. Now, it's not that simple, because socialism is sort of a twofold theory. It's a social theory and an economic theory, or I guess you could say it's an economic theory with a driving social assumption. Either way, stay with me here. This is quick and simple, and we have to do this, right? Because we got to understand these terms. The social piece, whether you want to call it an assumption of the economic theory or just the flip side of the coin, like an equal piece of socialism as a whole, the assumption is an inextricable binding sort of relationship that we all have to one another. You might say, few will make the nature argument. So you might say, in virtue of us all being part of the same state, it's inescapable. Okay, so the state is the thing. Okay, the whole, the group is the thing. And so what that means, if we flip to the economic side now, is that means that the important stuff, the resources, the capital, the means to produce the new things that we like and need, the important stuff needs to be owned by all of us, i.e. the government. Now, there's a sort of interplay between the two sides, right? And this is probably an argument for calling them two sides, because on the social side, the more needs you can identify and come up with, then on the economic side, the more justifications you can invent for it. In these terms, but confiscating more and more property and resources and capital, etc., etc. So you see this sort of interplay between the two sides. Now Marx thought, we'll come to Marxism in a second, but that's socialism. Now Marx thought that socialism was a natural progression on the way to communism. Okay, but look, if you know that, then you know the definition of both concepts, right? Because if socialism is a progression on the way to the end point, and the end point is communism, well, then what is communism? Well, communism is the utter and complete ownership of all those things we mentioned by the state. All right? So that's two of them, okay? But what about Marxism? Because here all throughout talking about communism and socialism, I've been saying Marx this and Marx that, but what about Marxism? What is Marxism? Now, there's a minute and a half left in the program, and I just think that this is, perhaps, if anything, requires its own full 29 minutes and 45 seconds, right? I think this question does, honestly. So that's what we're going to do when we come back for the top of part 6 of Unmasking Antifa. We're going to take a deep dive and we're going to look at Marx and some things that he said that I think you need to hear and understand in the context of what we've said so far. And then we will move forward. And where we go from there? Well, I keep promising it is a series about Antifa, right? We'll get there, I promise. It's Nick, it's 40 on Hemlock Podcast. I'll see you next time.